Today we're going to talk about, show how to set up a VPS so you can move over from your shared hosting over to your own VPS. The freedom that you get from having your own VPS is so much better. So much more freedom to do what you want to do. Not all the nonsense you have to deal with shared hosting. And you can do so for about the same price, if not less, money. It's really, if you know what you're doing, it's time to make the change. So I've got here this worksheet. You can download the worksheet on my website right there. And the video that you're watching here is right here. After I record this video, I'll get a more exact address on this file. This is the worksheet. What it is the first part of the worksheet is you got the data. And you enter it, we'll walk through this whole thing, and you put in your information, and you do so by doing a find replace. We just hit, usually it's Control H on most web most text editors, and it replaces all of them at the same time. And so you just go through and do it all, and then that way, when we go down through the rest of it, it's just copy and paste. All the information is there already. There'll be a little bit of tweaking, but for the most part, you just copy and paste because all the information we filled out at the beginning of the file is also down here, and it makes it so much easier. And then watching on the video at the same time, having it seen, so you're able to see it done and you're actually able to copy and paste. It should make this very easy for you to make the switch. I'm using a word processor a text editor called Bluefish. You can use any kind of text editor. I wouldn't recommend using a word processor though. But probably want to turn off spell checking in your text editor. Like for example, here we got spell check, and then everything you click on, it's going to want to give you a bunch of word spelling. It just clutters up your work a little bit. So I'd recommend turning spell check off, and then so simple you can copy and paste easier. Also, turn off text wrapping so that your text does not wrap it when you put around, because we want the code to be accurate when you copy and paste. So turn that off. If you're using a Linux computer like I am, much prefer Linux over Windows. You'll want to return the format for the carriage return back to Linux format. If you have Windows, just ignore it because you're already set for Windows. But those who have Linux probably usually know what I'm talking about. Just change the carriage return of this file so that it's just the Linux format. If you have Apple, you probably want to change the ending to Apple format. Okay, so the first thing to do is if you don't have a VPS to get one, you can go to DigitalOcean, use this reference code, and you can save off your invoice. Currently, it's $100 off, so your first $100 is free in credit for 60 days. You can right now, prices always changing, so click one. But the current price for the cheapest server right now is $5 a month, or you can set up for just a few hours and pay less than a dollar. But anyway, so let's do that real quick. Go to DigitalOcean, click set up your account. Click Create, click Droplet, go with Debian. You could use other operating systems, but the instructions I have are geared towards Debian, so you could end up might have to tweak things if you use a different operating system. Debian's a really good, highly recommend Debian. I think it's the best one to use for a server. And then you got your droplets. Usually it shows up over here. You've got $40 to $80, but you just click this arrow here. You can go on $5 a month. That's 1 gigabyte, 25 gigabyte disk space, 1,000 gigabyte transfer per month. These are the more expensive ones. And click on Add Block Storage if you want to add an extra hard drive to your system. Choose your location. I like New York. And give it a name. This is your default name. You can use that if you want. But, testing. And then click Create. And when you do that, you'll get an email that will give you information. What do we got here? We'll give you your IP address and your root password. So I already got that here in the file. This is the IP address for the one that I created. Temporary one I created. I'm going to delete this after the server. I got another server. But created this server a little while ago to do this video, and they sent me an email, and this is the root password. So that's what you'll start with. So let's get started on editing the first part. getting our variables edited. Okay, now that you have downloaded the worksheet, if you haven't downloaded, pause the video and download the worksheet so you can look at it. I'm not going to go through every comment that I have here. So you'll probably want to download the worksheet just so you can have it and peer at, take a look at it once in a while when you're watching the video. You might have a question about something. And the worksheet has more information. So together, you really need both. You really have a hard time doing this with a worksheet without the video, and you'd have a hard time doing this with a video but without the worksheet. So let's get started. Website. Basically, each variable has got several equals on it. We always have four. Kind of helps it stand out, but still, with all the comments and stuff, it can get a little. You could easily miss one. Down here, we have a little list that can go through. Everything that says my on it, the ones that we haven't changed yet. That way you can go through and make sure you haven't missed anything. We'll do that. So let's get started. My website. Oops. Highlight the whole thing, just like that. Most web browsers. Most text editors, the command you want is Control H. But you can look up here and see and find and replace. It's Control H. So it's faster. I mean, you could click on here if you wanted to. It's up to you. But anyway, and it's found 104 in this document. So we'll change it. So I'm going to go with this is basically your main domain. You may have several websites. If you just got one website, and that's fine. We've got a couple. Let's make this your main website that you're going to use in this instruction. So I'm going, but mine, I'm actually for this demonstration, I'm going to go with testing. Testing.WayneSallee.com. But normally you would have like it's a regular, your regular domain name here. And you want to make sure you do replace all, not just replace. And don't edit this in place. Replace all. And it just replaced 104. Let's see if we got that. Other website. Now for this, if you have another website, put that in here. If you have a subdomain for your website, put that there. If you have another subdomain, add that. If you have more than that, well, you'll have to edit that. You'll have to do that manually later on. And for this instruction, I'm not going to do the subdomains. Private subdomain. Create a private one. This will be used later for other processes. Yeah, you should have one that you use. This is something to use yourself, not for anyone else to access. So Control H. We'll call this place all. And then down here, because of some code down farther down, we need to have a backslash for the same thing. So basically, just copy and paste, copy this, copy, and Control H, Control V, and we put a backslash in front of each one, for each period. And replace all. Next one, my server name. You can use, I like using like server 1, server 2, server 3. A lot of people like using, say, colors or name of gemstones or name of mountains or whatever. Whatever theme you like to use. It doesn't really matter. It's just as far as what you choose, you can choose anything. It's just whatever, you know, consider the fact when you're naming it, consider that you'll, as if you're going to have multiple servers, even if you don't think you'll ever have more than one server. Just consider that you might have other ones. So consider that in your name and what you would like to call all your servers, what theme you would like to use. Personally, I'm going to go with server 4 on this one. Control H. But you can give it any name you want. You can call it Fred if you want to. Replace all. Alright. Mail. Default is mail. I like going with mail 1 or mail 2. I'm going to call this mail 4. I like going with the different, instead of using regular mail, just the default is mail.yourdomain.com. But I like going with some of the different number so that one, if you have multiple servers, it'll differentiate your servers easier. And two, it'll make it less confusing as far as moving from one, you know, gradually moving from one server to the other. You'll know what server you're connecting to. I just like doing that. I mean, you can use whatever you want. You can use the default, which is mail. But anyway, I'd recommend mail 1. Place all. And then that way, too, you know that you're going to your email software, you know that you're connecting. Assuming that you're using email software on your computer or phone or whatever, you know that you're connecting to the right location. And not the old one, not your shared hosting. Server admin email address. Ideally, these two email addresses should be the same. But if you want, you could, if you have a particular email address that you want your contact that isn't on your server, you can add that here and then put your server. I'm going to Control H. Replace all. Control H. Oops. There we go. Replace all. So this one here goes to my main server email address. And this one here will be on my testing, my default server for this one we're creating is the testing. And continue on. SQL database. I got four examples here. If you have more, you have to do so manually. For this demonstration, I'm just going to do one database. Control H. And let's say, for example, I got a forum that uses the database forum software. So I'm just call this database. But you probably already got, you already have a database name, so you can look at what you're using already and use the same name if you want. Or you can change it. But if you change it, that's just more you got to change later. Replace all. And we need a password. This is the password that your software uses, not the password you use. Make sure you use a good secure password. I don't care what kind of password I got here. I'm just typing something in. This is a demonstration. Replace all. That is not the password. Myself. Control. Don't do that. All right. This is the user. So it's like that. Call that user. Yeah, whatever. Let's go forumsoft. Replace all. Okay, now we got the password. Control H. You want to use the password that you more than likely want to use the password that you're already using on your current website, where your software is already using. But it's up to you. You can always change it now if you want to. If you feel like changing it, now it can be done. Replace all. Backup. You want to be able to back up your databases. So I got software here that we'll put in there. It will back things up for you. It'll do backup every day, and then you can tweak that to however you like to for it to work. Because you're gonna want to retrieve that and all that kind of stuff. But anyway, let's get that backup the user. There we go. The backer. Replace all. And now password. All right. Username that will manage your website. You can use, give it a name like web page manager or something like that. You can give it a person's name, whatever you want. I'm just going to call it Bob. Replace all. And let's see, a password. Basically, but anyway, Control H. Sure did. I'm messing up today. I'm getting too much of a hurry. SSH user is not, that is not the password. Control H. Okay, we have to go replace all. Okay, so that is the user that you'll be logging into. Bob is the website. You can log in as with Bob or the SS, but it, for security purposes, it's good to have one that's only for managing the website, and then one that logs into your server. It also makes it nice when you're looking at logging, and you can detect what's going on. Make sure everything's secure and everything, nothing's going on that shouldn't be going on. Okay, this is a default empty site. So when the hack bots go to your website, they'll get an empty page. And then if a legitimate person goes to your IP address to go to your website, they will be redirected to your website. But the bots tend to ignore the redirects, and they just keep looking for stuff. So that way it gives them an empty page, you can ban them. All right, so let's go. Nobody's home. Okay. SSH port. Default is 22. It's real common to use 2222. But I'd recommend looking, just look at this website, this is your URL here, you can go there and look at what various ports are used for. Find one that's not being, decide on a port that's not being commonly used and go with that. The idea here is you're using a port that the bots aren't going to look for. And so it helps keep them out of here, keep them from trying to hack into your secure connection. So control H, I mean if you want you can make it 22, that's the default. H. I'm going to make it just for this reference. I'm going to make it 22. 22, 22. That's pretty common, but I'd recommend you find something a little more original. Replace all. Okay, now we need Bob's password. Place all. SSH logger. Okay, we got. Okay. Now we'll put the password. Root password. Okay, this is the root password that they gave you. Also, good habit to be clicking on save. Save your document every once in a while as you're editing this. Save it. Then if something happens, you've got it saved. Computer crashes or whatever. After you've done all this time, gone through all this time, you don't want to. Always good to be in the habit of saving on a regular basis. Okay, anyway. Root password. We have a root password here. Copy. Control H. And remember, don't edit in place. It's easy to actually want to edit that in place. Control H. You want to replace all. SQL root password. Now, this is not the root administrator password. You'll have to be root to use SQL root, but this is a separate password for root SQL. My PHP MyAdmin password. If you're going to use a good secure password, hackers love PHP MyAdmin. They're always looking for it. We will be taking special measures to keep it secure. Control H. FTP, we'll set up an FTP, that's a high security connection. This is not for uploading your regular websites. Your regular uploading of a website will go through SSH. This is a secure connection that is cruded so that connection when you connect, you cannot see anything else. SSH tends to be more open. But this is for you or someone else. If you want to give someone else the ability to upload something to your site, but it's separate from your website. It's totally separate, its own little environment, secure environment. So create that. We need user. Let's see, we'll get a name. About I don't want to call that FTP. FTP user. There we go. It plays all. Password. Okay, directory for FTP, you can give any kind of name that you want. I'm going to be original and just call it FTP. Replace all. But it'll be var, and then whatever you name you give it here is where it'll be at. Alrighty. Server IP address, or server IP address, I'm going to save that again. There we go. Server IP address. Okay, your old server IP address. I'm not going to fill this out for the purpose of this demonstration, but put your current server where you got shared hosting, put that down, put that IP address down. It'll help in the transition as you're moving from one to the other. But with your email, you do want that there. All right. Time zones. I've cheated. I put my example right there, the one I want. Oops. This will be time zone, and later on instructions we'll go through it and show you. But recommend you set when you set it up, you want non-daylight saving time. You don't want it to switch back and forth. I mean, you can if you really want to, but I recommend you don't. So pick one and stick with it. Control H. Wish they'd just get rid of daylight saving time. It's just such a joke to have it. But anyway, maybe eventually everybody will get rid of it. Won't have mess with it anymore. And you can see your time zones here. Go there and decide which one you need. And I cheated again. Put mine here in the example. PHP time zone. That I like to let that be, along with the daylight saving time. This one, for example, will switch with daylight saving time. So software that uses PHP and uses date, it will use this one. And it will show when daylight saving time changes, it will change accordingly. So your people watching your video, go into your website, will see the correct time as daylight saving time changes. But all your files will be saved with one time. If you would do this as I recommend, there won't be a daylight saving time. So your server files are not switching back and forth. Not like that happens a lot, just once a year or twice a year actually, but anyway, that is my recommendation. You want a good stable server that times don't change, especially when you're looking at logs and all of a sudden time changes and all that. Just anyway. Control H. And again, you can decide, go here, and that'll help you decide what time zone to use. Secure your password. Give you a password. This is going to be used for our PHP admin to secure the location, keep people out of it. Add an extra layer of protection by securing the folder, the directory that is in. Link, www link. All right. With this instruction, we have the ability to add an extra hard drive. I like adding, getting a server that has doesn't necessarily have a lot of hard drive space, and then I add the extra drive to it. But anyway, but if you don't, that's fine. Anyway, so with this example, this video here, I'm not going to be doing the extra drive, so we'll make it www. And if you don't want www, you want to be different, you can name anything you want. But this is basically what default. I like being different. I like putting on another hard drive with a similar name, different name. So it's separate from the default. Place all. Additional hard drive. If you use an additional hard drive, decide on the label that you want to call it. I'm not going to do that in this example, but you'll see it later on. The instructions is real simple. Do that. Okay, we got through that. We messed up twice. Okay. Let's take a look and see if I missed anything. We'll look for the stuff that has my in it. These are the ones I've not done and I'm not going to. Let's see what else we have on my database too. So we got 2, 3, and 4. 2, 3, and 4. 2, 3, and 4. Current old server. So yeah, got it all. The ones I don't want, you know, are there, so I didn't miss anything. All right, let's do a little cleaning up. So we're gonna do a copy that and do a search for it. Actually, don't even have to copy; just control F usually on most computers to find it. And I'll show you what to remove. It'll depend on what you're using, but you'll get the idea. These are some optional stuff, like the ones I didn't fill out. You may not be using them. If you're not using them, you'll want to remove them. I'll go ahead and clean these out. If you have them here, remove these. If you have, you know, obviously if you have other website and you filled it out, you're not going to want to remove that, but it won't even come up in your search results because we're searching for that variable. Clear as mud, right? Okay, next. Another website. I'm not doing that, so we'll remove that. And that one as well. Let's see, it's got extra ver. Extra var. Delete. And let's save that again. Okay, next. We'll remove these. And that one. And that one. Okay, and then clean this one out, do that. things out. Base. Okay, here we take out these parts. That's what we got here. Comment, I'm not going to worry with that. Okay, this is in a file here, a large, pretty large file. And one of them is this one's a comment, and this one's actual code. So comments really not all that important, but we still want to clean up a little bit. Code. Take that out. That's just comment there anyway. This lower one. The lower one is code. Okay, save. Next. Almost done. Oops. Next. This whole piece right there. That whole line comes out. Of course, you may have filled all these out and may not be removing anything, but if you got any var, this we're searching for, the var also. Take them out. Of course, I just said that a minute ago, but you can see. Right there, almost there. And then the fun stuff. Take that out. But the nice thing about this is that when we get this done, then it'll just be copy and paste for the most part. It'll be, just makes it so much easier. Let me see what I did here. Yeah, that's right. Get to talk. Next. Okay. Take these two lines out. And now we're back at the top. And save. Okay, now we're ready to do some building. We'll type, copy the code into it and make it work. Okay, I was going a little fast in the first section there, filling in all the information, but it's pretty self-explanatory. But anyway, I did mess up twice there. I need to slow down. Just, we got a long ways to go. I want to get this whole, anyway. Here we go. You'll need, next thing we'll be doing now is we'll connect to the server. And if you have Linux, you're all set. Just go to the command line and we'll go follow the instructions. If you have Windows, You can use PuTTY. You'll have to, some of the commands like, here we go, this command here, you'll have to enter that in into PuTTY manually. And then once you get a terminal, then you'll start, everything will be back to like normal terminal connection. With Linux, you just, with Linux though, and with Apple, you can just enter this command on your command line, and it's so much easier. Linux is the way to go. So anyway, one thing you want to do is go to this IP address and check your IP address. Go to this web address and check your IP address to make sure it's not on a blacklist. You don't want an IP address that's on a blacklist. So there's two web addresses here. Check that real quick. All right. Oh, I'm trying to figure out what I was saying there. I probably should have made it a little more clearly. What I meant was this here. Okay. And then also when we get, if you're using PuTTY, you'll right-click and that'll paste it in. When we get later on to a special shell, which is really nice to have. The shell keeps everything running, so if you lose connection, you can go back and everything's right there like you left it. When you get into that shell, you'll have to use Shift right-click in order to paste. So if you're using PuTTY, at the beginning of these instructions, you'll just right-click and that'll paste. And then after you'll notice when we get in the shell, you'll notice that when you right-click, it doesn't paste. You have to use Shift right-click. But for those of us that are using Linux, it's so much easier. Okay, I think I covered everything. Be sure to read all this. Make sure you got no firewall. Make sure your firewall is turned off. We'll use the firewall inside the server. We'll manage the firewall in the server. We don't need an external firewall getting in the way. Okay, so we've got a root. We'll run this in the command line. You'll have to put this manually into your PuTTY if you're using PuTTY. So let's copy that. And start up the terminal. Paste. All right, it's basically saying, we don't know who this person is, who this server is. We've never been there before. And so I say, yes. That's what you're going to say. Yes, we want to continue. And now it has added that IP address to the list of known addresses, known hosts. All right. Move this thing over. Okay, where did we go to? Oh, yeah. It needs a password. Root password that was given to us when we set up the account. Made the server. Paste. Entire. And now it says, need to change password. And so the next command is password root to change the password, but it's already asking us that, so we will not need to enter that. It's doing that for us, forcing it on us. We want to change it. So let's come up with another password. Oops. Control H. So come up with a good password that you can remember, that's good and secure. You can remember that, can't you? All right, replace all. We did Control H and replace all. That way, all the rest of the passwords down below are adjusted. Because anywho, all right. So copy So we want a new password. If you're using another service and it does not ask you for that, I'll go ahead and do this anyway just to kind of show you. All right, current password. Didn't get that yet. All right, let's get current password. Copy it. It's kind of crazy that asks for current password. Paste. Enter. New password. Copy that. Paste. Enter. I gotta retype it again. Repaste it again. Alright. Root at test droplet. And that we'll be changing that later on. Alright, but if you didn't get that automatic change, you got something else. What you can do is you run this command. Copy. Paste. It'll ask you for a new. Now here you'll notice it doesn't ask you for your current password. It just asks you for a new password. You type in a new password. And it'll give it to you. I mean, it'll take it under twice, but then it'll do it. But I'm not changing it because I already just did. So just type in. Wait a minute. Okay. That's backspace. So what I'm going to do is just hit two different passwords that are not the same. It should error out, but it might ask it for it again. There we go. You'd think Control-C would have stopped it, but it didn't want to stop. But anyway. Save. Make sure you save your file. We just made some changes there with the password. Be in the habit of changing. Anytime you make changes to a file, always be in the habit of saving it. A lot of programs have automatic backup, but even still, be in the habit of saving. All right. Also, if you plan on using outgoing email, make sure your port 25 is not blocked. So you can run this command and change example.com to some other website you want to bug. Try telnet 25, and it'll check, allow you to see if it goes. You'll get a connection, and anywho, if you're not planning on doing email and you don't care, then okay. So anyway, if you see a connection too, then you're good. You just disconnect. If your VPS provider is blocking outgoing 25, port 25, they usually don't block incoming, so that way you can still get email, and you can still send and receive email on your own server. You just can't send email out. Personally, I would not want a VPS that I couldn't send email out. Okay, let's get going. We're going to do a little installing here. Okay, this is already installed. And you can go here and see what all has been installed. It's kind of helpful sometimes. But here's all the stuff that's already installed. Hit Q. So you can get an arrow up. I think if I test an arrow up should work in Putty. I don't remember if I tested in Putty or not, but arrow up gives you the last command. But anyway, on this you can do a page up, page down, page up, page down, a variety of things. Anyway, Q gets you out of it. And then we're going to do update, upgrade, get the current stuff updated, make sure it's up to date, what's currently installed. Looks like everything is up to date. And you can check your version. See what version you got. Make sure you got the latest version, 9.7. And you can see what date is, the time. There we go, February 8th, 18th. UTC. Universal time. We're going to change that. Unless you're in UTC zone, universal time zone, you're probably going to want to change that. Let's get the time set. Okay, now assuming that you want to take my advice and have non-changing time zones, in other words, they don't change with daylight saving time, click none of the above, and then choose your time zone. Which of course won't work. Can't click on it. All right. Enter. Of course, it showed the date here anyway, but you can type date and you can see it's changed. -5. And you can look, see what kind of users you got here. We got one that we're going to remove. There's one we're going to remove that we don't need on there. Copy. Hard to talk and select at the same time. Okay, there we go. We got Rudy. Debian, that's one we're going to get rid of. Alright. Dmux, this is really nice. And then also vmdbus.copy. Dmux is what allows us to have a shell that really makes it so much better. It's just the difference between 9 and day. Set some Vim settings here. Vim the command line text editor. Let's go with what we got here. Settings for updates. So we can get newer stuff, but it'll default to most recent stable stuff. But there's one program where we're going to need a newer version. Thought I had another command on there to look at that, but anyway. Well, that was later now. Okay, work on our source list. You can use the original ones they got. You got ones that come with it, but I like just knowing what I got and being all my stuff inserted in. So we know we got just real simple. And if you're on Debian, Ocean, Mirror, so. If you were on DigitalOcean, go ahead and add these mirrors, local mirrors. And yes, they were already there, but we commented them out. I put a, modified a little bit here anyway. Forgot to mention, I'm using these here. You probably already figured it out, but these little things. Basically, it allows you to see when you're doing a copy and paste, when I got like a large file here, or a file of text. Some of them are pretty good size. So that way you know when you're copying and you got like more than one screen worth, you know that until you see that, you got to keep highlighting all the way down. And that's the end. Then you know you got the end of it. Later on, we'll get some larger ones, and it really helps having this to know a quick glance how much you need to copy. And then we'll look at our modified source list. There it is. There's all this up at the top there. It's all the stuff that was originally there. And that's what we've added. Nice and neat. Set up there. Now let's do another update. This actually is an update what we just changed. Update to our changes. Apt update just updates the system as far as looking what's set up. Apt upgrade then updates all the packages. Okay. This is just shows the error. The order that we set before with the updates. 700 means that's what you want. What it's going to default to, which is stable, and then backports would be second, and then testing would be last. It'll always use that, but it's not going to use testing unless you really actually specify testing. But it makes it available. Same thing with backports. Let's see. Too much talk. Let's get moving. Copy. All right, now we're at Tmux. Now, if you got if you're using Putty, this is where it's going to change as far as right click. You have to do a shift right click after running this. Also, for highlighting, you have to use shift, press hold shift key, and then click and drag. If you don't use the shift key, it'll highlight it, but it's not going to really get it. It's not going to copy. It's not going to let you copy. So, if you got Linux, using Linux, you'll need to shift click, like I'm doing right there. Okay. Yes. Remove user Debian. We don't. It goes to that. No, I guess because we didn't uninstall that, removed it. Oh, okay. No, there we go. Just mail on that file. Okay, let's do some more settings. Bash RC. I like doing that. Where you just comment the other stuff out, put your new stuff there. That way, if you're wondering, well, what was there before? What did I remove? It's not really removed. It just commented out. And you can look at it again and see what you changed, what used to be there. Default profiles. And you can look and see things here. Basically on this, where I have several in a row, like for example, I got two in a row, then it's run them both. You can run them both at the same time. Where I got them separate, I really intend for you to run them individually, you know, separate. But I'm running it together anyway. There it is. What was I doing? Groups and passwords. And there's all your users and all that good stuff. Some of this I'm going to skip through and not actually run, but still you probably want to run it just so you can see what's going on. But some of that just for the time of this video to help shorten it a little bit. I'm going to skip some of this stuff that isn't necessary, you don't have to run, but it's good to look at it. Depending, it's at the least it's there. If later on you're trying to troubleshoot and you're like, well, what's going on? You can, you know, okay, here's a command I can run that will allow me to look at what's going on. And you'll want to keep this document later on, so you weren't making changes to your server. You'll have that information that allow you to make those changes. And then be sure to make those changes in your document here, in your worksheet, so that later on you go back to do it, work on it again. All that information, all those changes you've made are documented. Document, document, document. Okay, Unix, we added this our SSH loginer, and it needs a new password. And our password is right there, so nice and convenient for us. Because we filled out all that paper, all that stuff ahead. Enter. And you gotta retype it or repaste it. Okay, you can leave this blank. If you want to fill it out, feel free to do so. I never do. Yes, that is all correct. There we go. Alright, we're going to add this group person to our SSH users. That way, other users cannot connect by SSH, only those in the SSH user group. Cat. Okay, if you have a Linux computer, read this. Otherwise, ignore it. This will probably work well on Apple. If you have an Apple computer, it should help you, be useful for you as well. There are Windows settings you can do that are similar to this, but alrighty. So Windows computer now on the server. We'll do this. Restart SSH server, and what that'll do, that actually will not disconnect us, but it will affect our connection. Copy. So. Okay, now there are two methods of doing this. One is a safer method, which I'm going to use. If you have PuTTY, you can right-click up at the command line and then tell it to open another terminal, whatever wording it uses. So one method is just exit out and then try to log back in. But it's better to open another one and test it first. Otherwise, that way you're not locked out. Because the changes could, if you did something wrong, the changes, or whatever reason, you have some kind of firewall blocking that you didn't turn off. And so, copy. We're now checking to make sure our new port It was working. So, new terminal. Paste. And it's working. So let's go to password. Paste. Enter. Password works. I'm going to go SU. Which is easier just to type it in. And root password. See how nice it says have a root password. All your passwords right here through this worksheet. By doing it ahead of time, it just makes it so much easier. You got to keep going back and forth. Paste. Enter. Okay, and then Tmux. But I've already got Tmux here. should change that. Okay, where am I? There we go. but anyway. So what we're doing instead is Tmux attach. I've got this later on in the instructions. You can just can't close this off. But I'm going to show you something anyway. See, oops. Ta-da. Now let's see if we go open this term. You can see it resized it. Because we have another terminal open. And you watch when I put type something in. It'll show up over here. Whatever I type here or type there shows up both places. Because it's a shell, which is really neat. Hi there. What if I'm here? Anyway. Oh, okay, because it's all hidden. We haven't changed that setting in there to automatically show hidden files. Anywho, what you can do with a command, but anyway, let's get back to what we're doing here. Where am I? There we go. So you can see you're able to log in. That's good. But I want to make sure that there's not a port 22 also listed. Because otherwise, if there's both of them listed and not commented, you'd still be able to connect in port 22. And we don't want bots being able to find port 22. It's going to be not available. Now I'm just going to close this one. Let's see, maybe maximize just in case. Make sure this is the right size. Yeah, that one. And there's port 22. And it's commented it out. And come on down. There's no other port 22. But there's our port there. So we're good, which I already knew it would be, but on some systems it's possible that might be there. So you just want to make sure. And to get out of this, you hit the colon, X. And that will save all your changes, too. Any changes you made, you have to use quit in order to get out without changes. All right. So now let's restart. Oh, we don't need to do that. There was no, nothing needed to be changed in that, so no need to restart. All right. If it was, we had to comment something out, and then we change that, and we need to restart. Make sure you can connect via port 22, but cannot connect. Yes, let's make sure we cannot connect. Copy. Bots can't find us. So, open another one. space, connection reviews. So good there. Now I'm going to start fresh connection. Copy. Paste. Password. Copy. Paste. Enter. I'm going to close this other one. Okay. And as SSH user, we want to change the files there. Anyway, let's see. All right, that's you. Team locks attach. And there it is. There's all of everything that was there, right where we left off. Really neat method. You work on something, get loose internet connection, or you have to finish it later on some other day. You go back, everything's right there, just as you left it. We're turning off root. See, we connected originally by root, and now we're going to disable root by doing that. Restart. Another nice thing about this shell is that you get a nice little green. So you don't confuse. If you're using Linux or Mac, you're not confusing this with one of the other terminal that's on your own computer. So you know you're on external. Kind of separates it nicely. All right. And again, we got two options. We could exit, or do a lot safer. Just do another terminal so that way you don't get locked out if something went wrong. In fact, right here, you're not going to get in. If everything works right, you won't go get in. Based. It'll ask for the password, and it'll pretend like you gave it the wrong password. It's really just rejecting it. Root password. Because it's no longer allowing root login. And there we go. Permission denied. Try again. And you can keep giving the password all day long. It will not let you in, which is what we want. You have to log in as your other user, and then if you want to be root, you have to su to root. Cannot log in as root. Alright. Now we want to make sure that you're still able to log in. Make sure nothing gone wrong there in those changes. Better to find out now than to find out later. Enter, and we're in. That's true. All right, Toonbox attach. And now we're right back. Looks like we never left. Close that one. All right, now we're our host name. See how it says test droplet? We don't want that. We want our own. We want it to be our own server name, not. So we are going to fix that. Because there's other commands you're going to run, and then you think you got it, and it reboots, it goes back. So we're taking care of this. Because it keeps changing, so we're telling it, no, you're not changing anymore. You're not going to mess with our settings. And that's just in case we've got an error. Okay. Cat's name. I'm going to copy this. Now we want to make sure that our host name is correct, so we are going to reboot, and we'll just give it a little log thing too. It shows up in the log. That way, it's a nice little thing if you're troubleshooting. All right, connect. Password. Password. But anyway, it's working. Server 4. Instead of test server, it's showing server 4. You know, whatever name you give it, that's what it'll give it. But that was a quick, that was weird. Usually it's. Kind of threw me off there. And we can go and look at, let's do Tmux first. And see, our Tmux shell has been closed, so there's all that we had before showing up there. There's nothing to scroll up and down. There's nothing there. Because the server, we rebooted the server. So we're back with a fresh Tmux shell. Host name, control status. And there it is. Interesting that was there. But anyway. I'm gonna run this one. If that makes a change. I was testing this on another server system. And rebooting it. I guess what threw me off before, well, see, there it's still showing, you know, like a normal. I don't know. Just when it closed last time, just strange. Just seemed something threw me off. Something just. Anywho, let's go over to connect. Password. Enter. Yes, true. Password. Tmux. I like doing pretty much everything in Tmux for a variety of reasons, but one being that you get this green bar here, and it keeps you from confusing that with other terminals that are on your computer. You're not typing the wrong command in the wrong place. Let's try that again, see what we get. Let's see if it's any different. Nope, same thing. Just thought I would see if it changed that. But that's alright, it shows up, as that's the main thing. Alrighty. Now let's do some installation. Get some stuff installed here. We did install a few things already, but you want to run and get something, a quick snack real quick. Right now it's a good time to do it. Just take a little bit of time. Not real long, but let's get up and stretch your legs. Oh, all done. Break's over. All right. Firewall. We had just installed firewall. Well, we've installed UFW. Yeah, there's the main thing still there, already there, IP tables. I assume. Oh, we got it here, though. Sometimes it's, a lot of times they have that default anyway. We need to get server anyhooey. It'll show that UFS status is inactive. Now we will inactivate it by default deny and only allow our connection there right now. SSL connection. And later on, we'll be opening these other ones as we install other things. The nice thing about the firewall is you can keep stuff blocked until you got the software installed. And then once you have a particular software installed, and it's working, then you go ahead and open up the connection. That way you don't have bots trying to get into your software before it gets fully installed. Alright, we can run these commands. Okay, there we go. Let's do that one, though. There it is. Some stuff you can look at to see where's firewall stuff. So skip that. Then we need to make sure that our firewall is not blocking us, which it won't be, but it's better to double check. Make sure you didn't do something wrong. What did I just do? You sure you want to continue? No! I need to wake up. I'm getting too sleepy. New terminal. I think it's time for me to take a break. New terminal. Paste. Password. And it's good. We got in. No problem. Well, we'll go ahead and close that one. I still got this other one we use. Move that. All right, hard drive. If you are using an additional drive, there's an instruction. It's real simple. You don't need this, but I'm going to just kind of show you what we got. This one here probably, anyway, copy, it might get an error. But this will kind of let you look at your hard drive. Ain't that pretty? Oh. All right. But anyway, follow these instructions for an extra hard drive. If not, just skip that section, come right here. Apache. Okay, this, now we're ready for do Apache for web server. Oops. And copy paste. All right, move this thing. And common name needs to be what you got there. You'll see that in a second. Go ahead and copy it. Actually, I think it's just simple. Delete needs to be done. Anyway. Country name. State. City. Organizational name. I'll leave that blank. Let's see. Common name. That's the one. Wait. Common name. Yes. Paste. Email address. This is just basically contact email. You want them to send an email to. Done. Okay. Copy. And it's always good when you type something like that in and you get no errors. If you get errors, you did something wrong. And run these. Let's add Bob so we can edit the website. All right, password. Enter. As you can see, this really isn't that difficult. Just follow the instructions. But you do need to be willing to learn because. All righty. Enter a new value for password. Full name, we just leave them blank. You can put information if you want to, but I never do. Yes, it is correct. And add Bob to SH user so he can connect, otherwise he will be rejected. Copy. Get him some web directories. Get him set up. And of course, you'll notice some of these things are different on yours depending on what you entered in. And you may, when you're watching this video, you may actually see some slight changes in the file too. I might make a few improvements on it. But. All right, copy, paste. Get Bob set up here. With some default settings. The nice thing too is if you don't like some of those default settings and you decide later you want to change them, so you got the instructions right here on how to do it. And then just don't forget to modify your instructions so you know later how you did it. You might even want to keep an original just in case you want to go back to the original. Backup, backup, backup. Alright, make directories. These are separate, but you can go and run them all at the same time. Set up redirect browser. Alright, what we got here? Falling asleep again. Oh, yes, okay. This will tell web browsers that go to your IP address where to go. Paste to go to your main website. And your bots that are trying to hack on your website will ignore that usually. And they'll keep getting nothing. And they'll get banned. We will ban them with our fail to ban software. And we're back to root again. Okay, we got two methods here of uploading websites and getting them set up, maybe make them enabled. I like using number one, but for this instruction, I'm using number two, which if you just have a very simple website, you may end up wanting to just use number two. But so that is what I'm going to do. You can read that information. And we're going to do number two. Yeah, there we go. So nobody's home for the bots. Copy. Copy, and you may have more websites there. But I just got those two. Oh, wait, yeah. Grab that one. So I got that one. And fix permissions. reload Apache. That's good, no errors, everything's going good. And you can read that, see what's going on. Actually, let's go ahead and do that. Thought there'd be more there. PHP. I have several options of being able to use different versions because sometimes different programs on your website need different versions. Copy, especially if you're using an old program that has no more, nothing. All right, paste. Sometimes you're going to have an update in a PHP that everything's working fine on a program, PHP program, then you do a PHP update and it won't work on that version anymore. It's not compatible with the newer version, so you just tell it use the older version. Copy. So it's good to have a different version to fall back on. And of course, not going to exist, no such thing, which is good. It never does, but just in case. And app update. Because we just made changes to our update, our file, update file. Alright, now let's do some installing. Copy our source list. Yes, indeed. Okay, and you'll see over here on the instructions, it says choose Apache 2 and select no unconfigured database. Apache 2, enter. And the next one will come up in a minute. And we want no. Enter. You're seeing this because. You can list those and see what you got. I'll list. Copy. Paste. Now we're going to edit each one of these files here with a very simple process here. Now what I'm doing here is I'm disabling a lot of functions in PHP. I like to take the firewall approach with PHP INI. I like to disable a lot of stuff that's not needed, and if a program really needs it, and some of these programs they use it but don't really need it, and so you can disable it. But if you got a program that needs it, then you can come in change them, to take one of these out to enable. But some of these things I'm disabled here are hackers like to use. They like to get into it, find a vulnerability in your software and use these commands. So I take the firewall approach. I block everything that's not needed. Copy. So I got it on, and you can see, got these little lines there to let you know. All of that. All right. Paste. And there it is. Just edited those files. Okay. Okay, and then here you just usually leave it on auto mode. But if you're, let's say you had 7.2 or something, 7.2 is kind of a more like a beta version, so it's, and newer version. You maybe have it, maybe you need it or something, but don't want your other stuff on there. You can go in there default here. There's some other settings too for controlling which PHP you use on different programs. So you can have different stuff using different things, but anyway, this is your default. So we'll click OK, enter. All right, skip all that. And I'll go ahead and put it under one list. So this stuff, a lot of this stuff I'm skipping, but you probably want to go ahead and run them just so you can look and see what you got in that party. Okay. And of course, there's a million ways to skin a cat. No, we don't skin cats here. Control status. That's just first status. Copy. System reload. No errors. That's good. All right, we're done with PHP. Yeah, PHP. All right. So just some comments there. All right, PHP my admin. This is one the hackers use. We're gonna make it nice and secure. Hackers like to get, but they won't get ours. Vim. Copy. Paste, there it is. Now this one is just a little bit confusing, so you have to kind of pay attention. Don't want to fall asleep on this one. Alright. At the very beginning of the file, we have the directory, user share php my admin. You'll find those three lines, and then afterwards, we want to add this. So let's copy that. Right there. Copy. Remember, it's those lines we're looking for right near the top. Hit the word I for insert. That allows you to edit. If you forget, you'll make a mess of it. And you want to hit quit, not regular exit. You want to cancel your mess. All right, there's the two lines. I'll put a little extra line in there. Let's see, right there. Control Shift V. And there we go, right up the lines. You got that code there. And then we need the other, a little farther down here. This is what we need to find. Now we need to add these three lines. These three lines there. All right, we're looking for ifmod, and it's right before the first end directory. There's some other end directory, but we're at the first section. Don't go too far down. If you come down here, there's your ifmod, and there you go, right there. You see there's several others, but it's right before the first end directory. If you go farther down, you can see there's other end directories and such. You got directory here, end directory there, end directory. You want this one. And hit that in there. And there you go. Just make sure you put it in the right place. And this one takes just a little more attention than the other stuff. Escape to take off, turn off insert, colon. All right, try that again. Colon, X. Let's see what I got here. Secure folder, create a secure folder so bots don't even see the folders, the information there. Copy. Do read the comments there. I'm not. Okay. That's where it is. Copy. Trying to go through this relatively fast. Being that this video is going to be quite extensive. Okay. Add password, Bob. And that is your secure area password. When you go to that, try to go to phpMyAdmin, you will get a pop-up that says secure area. And you'll have to enter a password, this password. Without it, you don't even get to see the files. You don't get to see anything. So you can't hack it. You can't hack what you can't see. Because you get nowhere. You're just like a brick wall. Nothing, no access. Alrighty, I'm going to do this. Reload Apache. Microsoft 8. Anytime you get a service fail like I just got, you don't want to go any farther, you want to find out what went wrong. So, I'll just run this command right here. Copy. Okay, that didn't tell me anything. Try this command. Q to get out of that. Try it again. I don't know. Weird. But it worked a second time. I just couldn't see anything that would prove really reason for the error in those files. Just ran those commands. But if you ever get an error going through this process, don't ignore it, because it'll just be harder to fix later. Run the commands like I did. And usually it'll give you the error. But there was no error. It just, I don't know. Weird. But it worked second time. Alrighty. Still, let's see. Yeah. Copy. Open it up. Okay, now your server is set up. Web server. Well, not yet. You can go to PHP. Test that out. And you may notice some errors, like PHP uname. It'll still work. It'll give some errors. And that's up to you if you want to go back to our, let's see, let's do this. Control C, no control, oh yeah, it's control, yeah, let's go copy it. Control find. That way we find our way back real quick. If you want to come back here, I'll show you what I'm talking about. PHP INI settings, like I said, take the firewall approach and block a lot of things that are not needed. Like PHP version number, things like that. When you run, this is under PHP INI. So when you run your PHP myadmin, you will see it show a few errors. There are things that it doesn't need. And that's up to you if you want to say, well, I don't like getting those errors. So you can go back up there and you can enable it. But most of that stuff you don't really need. In fact, even PHP myadmin, you're going to find that once you get used to doing things on the server, on the command line, you'll find that you don't even need this. But I know it's hard for you to give that up right now after coming from a shared hosting. But so it's there. It's available. But eventually you'll get to where you won't even need that anyway. So it's all set up and secure. MySQL. Actually, it's MySQL is not set up, so it's limited what it can do right now. But anyway, we're going to continue on getting this set up. Copy. Based root password, and that's the root, not your server root password, but it is your MySQL root password. Copy. Change root password. Now you can say no because you already created a new password. You already have a root password, so no. Remove anonymous user, and of course this information is over here, as you see. Select no to root password. Select yes to the following. And there it is. So yes to remove anonymous users, we don't want that. Yes. Or yes to disallow root login, yes. Remotely. Remove test database. Yep. Reload privilege tables. Yes. Now, yes. There you go. Okay. Copy. Password. Copy. create user, Bob. He needs to have access to MSQL files. Paste. Grant permissions. And create him default path database. And for automated backup system, set that up. The backup user will have access to copy the SQL files to a backup location, but it will not have permission to modify those files that it's backing, the original files, which is a okay. Safety thing. And then exit. Let's see, Bob. Directory. Okay, what we're going to do is you basically upload it with your favorite FTP software, like FileZilla, to your temp directory we just created, and then we'll use these commands to copy the database into your new database on your server. I am not going to be uploading anything here, I'm just going to make a demonstration thing for testing kind of thing here. To make a from your current server to back up, you would use a command similar to this, and that would create your backup. You could also use MySQL. MyPHP, PHP MyAdmin to make a backup. But on the command line, you can actually do this. You'll make a backup, and then down here, you would have to modify this because your backup will most likely have a date on it, and so you'll need to modify this according to that date so it will copy the file and put it in. So I'm just going to do this real quick here. Just create an empty database file just to show how this thing works, kind of. There it is. There's our file in the temporary directory there. And copy this. Paste. See, there's two methods of this. One is to just run the whole thing in one command. The other thing method is to actually sign in and then run the commands individually. And for this purpose, we're doing the second. We're using the first method first and the second method second. Paste. Something like that. Show databases, and it will show our new database that we just created from an empty file. And there it is. And copy. And show tables. Now, tables were empty, but if you uploaded your database and ran through this process, you will see the tables, and you'll see, yep, they're all there. It worked. And there is an empty set of tables. And exit. And then, after you do that, you'll want to remove your temporary. The files you temporarily uploaded, just get them out of there so be more secure, not leaving them up there in your temporary directory. And now we'll go back to root by typing exit. All done with Bob for now. blog rotate. That's important because your web blogs, you want them to rotate monthly. So each month you'll have a compressed set of logs. And if you've been using shared hosting and you've never looked at your raw logs, you're really missing out because you can see a lot of information on your raw logs. Right. So that one. A little information for you to read there. Fail demand. Well, you can look. Oh yeah, we need to do that. So we're going to replace these two that are already on the file and add the other. So now insert. Always get insert first before you scroll down because then you forget to hit insert and then you end up with a mess when you try to paste something in. Now we're going to install fail-to-band. Fail-to-band can be a little tricky, but it's pretty good at banning the bots, getting them off your website. Copy. Nice long one there. Now you'll know some of these are false. We're not going turned on to begin with. Because failed man likes to be difficult. And if one doesn't work, failed man likes to just say, I'm not going to work at all. Paste. Could be a bit finicky. Let's see if it works here without any errors. My God, no errors, that's good. If you get any errors, try that. It kind of forces to make it work. It's not a fix, it just gets it running for now. Let's see, if you look at your logs and see what's going on. Information there, but should put on there all done. Anyway, that's it for some information on how to unban stuff. Because you can look at this here, basically show you what's being banned. I'll type in copy. Why are you saying nothing right now? Sure, I hadn't banned someone already. There already is. That's not much information. But it'll get going. Especially after we start turning the other stuff on. Let's stop. Anyway, last command, we should have started that, right? Restart, yep. And it worked. No errors, so we're good. Uploading websites. What you basically do is change the user. You can, if you're Windows, if you're Linux, you'll use tar. BZ. Tar is a good way to go with Linux. If you're using Windows, you'll probably want to use a zip file. And you upload them to your page. Trying to go through this quickly keep this video from being too terribly long. But these are the commands you'll use to extract them and then remove them afterwards. Remove the zipped files. And you'll want to run this afterwards. When you upload individual files with FileZilla, it'll automatically adjust the permission settings. But when you upload a full and extract, sometimes that can affect your permissions. And we did some other work here that needs to be adjusted here. So let's go ahead and run those too. Make sure we're good on that. Guess we already got there. Let's do cron. Get crons set. Get some crons set up here. Start check. Just want to make sure your certificate is up to date. Secure certificate. Let's got a couple of them here together. Goes all the way down here. So you get this little line here. I probably should have used that as the default server setting. It's default server email address. I would have changed it. Copy. It's better. It's much nicer if you got your like before. I was telling you those two email addresses, where it's better to have both of them on your same server. But it did split some of them just so you could. For people that do have a preference there. Alrighty. Let's go on down. And then one of these is a database backup, and you can modify it. Basically what it does is it puts it, each morning it backs it up, and then it replaces it and deletes the old one. And you can turn off the delete function in here or do whatever you want to. So take a look at what it's doing, how it works, and then decide what you want to, how you want it to be. And then exit. Back to root. Copy. All right. And then we'll want to change this for to 12:01 a.m. So insert I. That was one. And I like making this a zero, even though that should be fine. Just the way I am. Escape. Colon. X. Back to Bob again. Cron tab E. And X, it asks what you want for your preferred editor. I like Vim, not Vim Tiny, but Vim Basic. If there's one you like better. There's Nano. Nano is pretty popular. But I like Vim better. That's what we've been using all this time, Vim. 7. Okay, what are we doing here? Can we add these two at the end of the file? Make sure we hit insert. Forget to hit insert and hit control paste. You'll end up with a mess. And I always like to have an extra line at the end. Anytime I'm doing this, I always like to have a blank line at the end. If you run a cat statement that just to print out the file, it works. Everything works better. Escape. And then you can run that and see your crons. But you're just going to see what we just put in, so there's really nothing special about it, but it's a nice little command to quickly show you. Now we'll exit. And there's crons. We can list those. Let's do root crons. We should be in root. Double check. Yep, we're in root. All right. Copy that. This one is not really good. These crons here will let you know if someone tries to sign in, or whenever someone successfully signs in. Copy. Let you know when updates are available and if you have any security updates. So you can keep your server secure. Steam model, come on, let's do that. Limited FTP user. Let's go apt. Let's see. Yes, well, we're not using it. Okay. Additional drive method. We're not using that. We'll skip that. If not using additional drive method, then do that. Otherwise, don't do that. So one of these, either use that or use that, depending on whether you're using an additional drive method. Copy. Copy that. Pasteboard. Install. Paste. Adjust permissions, file permissions. So the log rotate will work. Restart. No errors, that's good. And you can look at your logs and all that. Open the ports. Paste. I should have done all that together. Save time. I think see we got a little difference in the permissions there. We adjust that. Website DNS. Okay, with the DNS, we will get this set up here. There's some information. You know, it's kind of up to you how you're going to do this as far as transferring things over. You want it as far as gradually moving, or what if you want to move. I moved all my email over first, and then after that was going well, I moved my website over. But you might also want to set up a test website and just kind of play around with it a little bit and that kind of thing. Make sure you're comfortable the way everything's working. But here's a quick rundown on doing the DNS. You can go on your shared hosting. You may not realize it, but your shared hosting has DNS settings, much like what I'm going to show you here on DigitalOcean. And you can see what your web hosting is showing, and then use that as a guide. And then I'm going to show what you're going to need. And I'm going to show you here. So basically, you can run this command here to take a look at what's showing up right now. And right now, I have no DNS for this, so nothing's going to show up, unless it pulled up old records on a testing that I had earlier. So, let's start with creating a DNS for server. We need a record for serve for, yours will be different, of course, pointing to the IP address. So let's start with that. Copy. And we want a record, which is what we're on right now. Paste. Now you're going to notice that it automatically puts your domain name there. So you don't want a duplicate there. So you only want copy, bring that back. So it looks like that. That still doesn't look right. Oh yeah, that's right. Let me double check that. Server 4 testing at WayneSallee.com. We need an IP address, and we already have our test droplet, which makes it easy. I don't have to type in the IP address. Create record. And it is created, and there it is. And we'll go back. And the next one here is the secure connection, which you may or may not want to add to it. It's the same thing, create a record for it, pointing to the IP address. That's up to you. It's a bit more secure if you don't list it, but if you want to use it, say with the because you can put it, you can put this in your host file, so that when you type in this address, it'll automatically go. But anyway, so I'm gonna skip that on this one, and then your other domains, if you have other domains, which I didn't create any other domains. And then also FTP is also an A record. Which actually, I really only need to copy that right there. Copy it. Test droplet. Create record. And there it is. And we'll be doing some more items there too. Later. Okay. That does not belong there. That will be, that's later on, down a little farther down, and gone. Save. Okay. That won't be there. All right. So now we got that done. We'll have more DNS to do a little later. In fact, we got DNS to do here. Let's encrypt. We want free certificates. Copy. Okay. Paste. We have problems. What's wrong? I think I've got that listed here. Yeah, that one fails. That's right, run the all in command, but it will push all dependencies. Okay, that one will fail. This one should work if you have to, but hopefully not to run that one. Copy. Paste. Done. No? Python bot was not found. Python would not fail. Okay. So yeah, we gotta eventually they'll have this stuff more up to date. We have to use this command here. So try the first one. That doesn't work. Try the second one. That doesn't work. Try the third one. Yes, install. Okay, start bot D testing. All right. Copy. Enter email address used for urgent renewal and security notices. WayneSallee.com. Please read term of service. I agree, whatever you say. I've already read it anyway. Mail address, electronic frontier, foundation. Yep, I already have anyway. Excellent. Yeah, why not? Probably put no last time. Are you okay with your IP address? Yes. Okay, we need challenge before running. So, what we need is to create this name. So, we'll copy this. Copy. And that's a TXT. What do we need? TXT. Copy. Paste. There we go. Paste your whole thing in. Copy. Paste. Create. Enter. Copy. Paste. Great. There they be. Okay, enter. It's taking longer this time. Congratulations. You did it right this time. Okay. Mm. And now we're going to look at our certificates, copy that they're there, which they will be. Paste. And there are all these certificates. That's good. No errors. If you ever get an error like that, you need to find out what you did wrong. Don't keep going. What's the deal here? Oh, okay. I thought I made an error in that. Copy. Paste. There they be. There's expiration date, 2019-509. Valid for 89 days. And then to renew the certificates, you just follow these instructions. And renew it. And then you'll get an email automatically letting you know that you got a certificate getting close to being expired. And that we've already set that up previously in our crons. And now we're ready for email. Okay, so we'll do the email. Basically, we got postfix and we got Dovecot. Postfix is the main mail server, and then Dovecot is what will handle your boxes, your mailboxes. So let's do a little installing here. Yep-er. Okay, and as you can see over here in the instructions, it says answer the question, system, internet site, and then system mail name needs to be whatever yours is. Copy. So internet site enter. And how does that compare? Testing. Yeah, so you just want to take the server part off. Whoops. What in the world? Internet site. Oh, I clicked on it. Site. Don't use the mouse, Wayne. Testing. There we go. So nice having control over your email and everything. Just do it all yourself as far as being able to control what goes on in your server and still having a shared server dealing with all that. Takes a little more knowledge and learning, willingness to learn, but it is so worth it. Let's run these. Oh, we don't. Yeah. It'd be all right. You know what? It's a good idea to run that, but just take a look at what you got there. I'm going to skip that for time there. Just looking at information. All right, let's get started on this. Nice long one here. Move that out of the way. Oops. It's like this operating system that I'm using on my laptop here. The operating system that I built. I like it so much better than Windows. The freedom to do what you want to do, the way you want it to be done. Let's see. So email addresses. And I got several test ones there. I mean, if you don't want those test ones, you can, of course, take them out. I'd recommend probably just having at least one test email there. See what else I just put in here. Nothing to go over there. Aliases. Oh, just basically forwarding kind of sort of things anyway. We got forwarding coming later. But it's similar. The way this comes out, it's like you gotta have both of these. It seems strange having duplicates, but it's kind of like this here goes to there. It's just the way it is. So. Virtual forwarding, so you can have various, you know, webmaster and all that go to your main email address. This for reject. This is a particular domain that likes to send junk mail, and you can just add in other ones if you want. And blacklisting domain, same one. And this command here is what gets sent back when the email gets rejected. It says, "You send too much spam. We don't want you. We don't want your email." Copy. Reject by headers. Basically, it looks for like maybe this one. Yeah, no subject. So if they try to get blank email with no subject, they'll send it back. And they'll say, "No subjecto! You seem to be subjectless." About to mess up again. Look at that. Talk and paste and copy at the same time. Copy. Paste. Let's make sure that looks good. Copy. And there it is. Gonna run that and show you our settings. Now we'll get a dovecot. Making folders. This is adds our configuration file. Oops, didn't get that return on there. Enter. And this is our configuration file that the previous command points to. We'll be set up POP3 and IMAP, and so whenever you set up your email software, whatever you set it up with, that's what it'll use. So it's not like you're choosing now which one you'll be using. When you set up your email software, you'll basically set it up, whether it be POP3 or IMAP, and the server will say, okay, we'll set up that way whenever you connect. All right, should all default settings, yeah. Get that one. It's a good idea to go ahead and run. No, just kind of familiarize yourself with what's going on there. That way it helps double check your work and everything. But since this video, we're trying to keep the length of this video from being quite as long as it could be. Hey, what am I doing? There we go. Looks like I hit a mouse key in there. So like that, wiggle the mouse button back and forth. The scroll button. That's what messed that command up. Don't do that. All right, restart. And everything goes good, no errors. Let's check what's going on with the mail log. All right, now the fun stuff. Now I'm going to create some passwords. So we'll just highlight this. We'll go back and get the ones we used. I just didn't have to copy, but anyway, control. Oh, good one, Wayne. Control find. Go up. Here's what we need. Let's copy our email addresses that we have in this file. Paste them in here to work on. And we need to create, put our passwords here. Let's make some passwords. This doesn't have to, this is just for our own working on there. It's not something we're going to copy and paste. That's only as far as spacing. This is right here. We'll copy and paste password. What have you. Gotta look a little nicer. Alrighty. Now we gotta make some SSHA 512 hash for each password, so we'll run this in the command line. And it's going to ask for the password. Save this document. So let's start with the first one. And repaste. What's the deal? Oh, I forgot to plug this in. Reminder popped up and reminded me I'm on battery. Oh, I've got power. Okay, enter. And you notice equals, sometimes there'll be no equal signs, sometimes there'll be two equal signs, sometimes just one. Copy the whole thing. A lot of times if you give it without the equal sign, it'll still work, but go ahead and give it with the equal sign anyway, even though it works sometimes. Just go ahead. Alrighty. Up arrow. Paste. Okay, I got first three, got the other two. Ah, come on, wait. Too much on the mind. Trying to. One, two, three, four. So we got the test. I'm going to go ahead and add the other ones in too. You probably won't want that many test emails, but the one test you'll probably want to do, and then you can remove that later. But that's up to you. But for the purpose of this, here, I'm putting all these in there. Although if you know how to do one, you know how to do several others. So anyway, it should look like that. So it's just basically a matter of taking these others. There you go. We got our email. So we'll just go and take this file, put this file in. There's our email address. It's the password database. Your emails. Email addresses. And you can, of course, take a look at it. There it is. We just typed it in. And of course, all users do need to be listed in this folder where we got these from. Otherwise, without password and without being listed, well, even if you're going to be listed but no password, it'll say user unknown. So you won't even get any mail. Not only will you not be able to get your mail, go in and log in and get your mail, but it won't even deliver into your box if you don't have a password. So don't think you just create the password later. If you're not going to get any mail in that box, it'll be rejected. User unknown is what it'll say. So make sure do the passwords for each of your email address. Copy. Again, if you ever do it, you're doing this, if it restarts and if you get an error, stop, figure it out. Don't keep going. You only make it harder. Alright, now we can test the email. Make sure it's working before we actually go live. And put your email, whatever email address in there you want to test with. Put your password. So that's Wayne. I want Wayne. That'd be this password. Wait a minute. No, this is plain text. Where am I going? It's plain text. Later on, we'll do it with encrypted. So Wayne, there's my password. Put that in there. Paste. Now we can test it. So I already did that, didn't I? Copy. It's over there waiting for me. It may have hung up on me. Nope. Paste. Successfully logged in. Now let's list. Let's see if I got emails, which I should. Should have an email. Copy. Usually you get like one email from this setup. Paste. Okay, no emails. Copy. Paste. We'll do another one later on that will actually send. Create an email, a sample email. Alrighty. Let's see here. Now we do some other encrypting here. So we need a password. Just don't get rid of that zero. Those zeros need to be there. So I'm doing test this time. We're going to create an email with that. So I'm going to go test email password. Test that Wings. Whatever. Actually, that's... Yeah, regular unencrypted password so far. We're actually going to encrypt it. Test. This one here. Highlighted that. Right here. If I'd highlighted it, I could have come back quicker, easier. Paste. Alright. Save. And we want to run that. Copy. Paste. And there's our password. Now you'll notice it. Wait a minute. Oh, there it is. You'll notice it put it in two lines. Sometimes it just put it in one line. Sometimes it might even put it in three, possibly. But it went the whole thing. Then we'll put it into one line. Let's put it right there, a little space here. This we're just doing with one email editor. We're not doing all of them. This is just a test here. So we'll go right there, go backspace, and that puts it all in one line. Be in the habit of saving your document every so often. If something should happen, you don't want to lose it. Okay, and then down here, you can also run. This one actually decoded. So, for example, if we take this, we just put in there. You don't have to do this, but you can take a look at how it works. Paste. And type that in. Copy. Paste. And there it is. That's what the information we put in there, and it's giving it back. We decoded it. We encoded it, and then we decoded it. Anyway, so there's our encoded, encrypted, whatever. It's Base64, anyway. Put it that way. Let's see. Next, we gotta do this. So we want to change this to this. Copy. And just whatever number of equals it comes with, that's what you want. Just depends. It has to do with a three bit. Whether you got 1, 2, or 0, 1, 2 equals signs. Okay, so we can run either one of these, this one here or that one, or you can run them both if you want. I'm going to take this one. But copy. And again, we're just testing here. Make sure it's working before we go live. That was good. Now we go to authorization. Logged in successful and quit. Everything's working good. Now we'll do this one. Make sure SMTP works. This one, port 25. Copy. Email. Paste. And you always got to say hello. Copy, you know, sort of like say hello back. Says mail for testing. It identifies itself. And quit. Everything's working good. Want to make sure email is working really good before we put it live. Let's run that one. And then we want to change this here, put our auth plane. This is where we're actually going to create a test email. So our auth plane here, we'll take this thing, copy, put it in here, paste. Got my mouse movement on there again. Why did I do that? I didn't touch the mouse. I don't know. And here we think I did. Hello. Authorization. Authorization successful. Alright, let's create a piece of mail. Copy that whole thing. Paste. Successfully sent. Now let's go see if we have email. You've got mail. So let's see. MX record. Now we gotta get our DNS set up and see what I had some old DNS set up for another test. Just run that and see what it does. It should, but this we gotta set it up for this, but we'll run it anyway. Hostmaster. Yeah, it shows testing, but it does have testing. That's MX. I didn't think I had testing MX. Maybe it's pulling up old stuff. I don't know. I thought I deleted that for this test, so we can start all over fresh on this one. Anywho, let's continue on. So we got to create a record for mail for, I know your guys are set up, so let's do that. Wait a minute here. Mail for, oh, okay, got server and not mail, yep. So let's go mail. And we gotta take off some of that, otherwise we'll get double it there. And it won't work. Mail for testing. And our string is the IP address. And we are in the wrong one. We need a record. All right, let's try that again. Paste. And you could just click test, drop it, or it would work too. I could have done that. Back here. Long wing. I can't talk and click at the same time. All right, copy. There we go, mail for testing. Wix.com. Alright, create record. That's an A record. Okay, now we need to create text record. Those are supposed to be A records. Wait a minute. Oh, okay, yeah, for email. And we've only got one ascending email here, so I'm just going to do one. So there it is down there. And that is what I'm going to use. The little squiggly line mains. And again, if you want to use, read this. I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail on this, but read it. And look at your old server, your current server settings, and you'll want to use that as a guide as to what you're wanting to use, because you may have other things like website welcome and such. The squiggly line, and make sure yours has, on your current one has squiggly line, which it usually does. The squiggly line means it can use this or other IP addresses. Eventually, when you get it completely switched over and everything's good, you want to change it to a straight line, which means anybody, any other server that sends email on my behalf is to be rejected. It's not from me. But right now, we're in the transition from moving from one server to another, even if it's your shared hosting. So you want to use a squiggly line. That way you're not rejecting the other one saying, yes, not, I'm the only one. So you got it all good and everything's working good, then you go ahead and change that to a straight line. And again, you look at it, you may have like website welcome or things you want to add into here. So look at what you got on the other one. You want your IP address and your old IP address can be put in there as well. But anyway, let's put that in. Test. And what am I doing here? Alright, that's cool. Oh, we know it's testing, so let's just do this. Copy. Alright, we want text message. A string there. Paste. And testing. It says testing.WayneSallee.com. And that's what, that's basically saying what email, let's put it this way, what websites you're going to be, this server is going to be sending email for. So when it looks here, it says, okay, testing.WayneSallee.com, email will be handled by this server. Create record. Okay. Okay, now it's all set. We got our DNS set up. We had already tested it, make sure everything worked. And now we'll open it up to the outside world. Basically. Yeah, but anyway. Copy. Paste. And we can look at our logs. I highly recommend you take a look at this. Copy. Let's see. Okay, everything looks good. You'll see one warning here. And this is what we're going to work on next. This helps to prove that you are the rightful sender of the email. So this is giving us a warning because we got the settings in it telling it that we wanted to use this OpenDKM. But it's looking and saying, well, there's no such thing. So we're going to create it now. Get a little bit of space in there. Just, a lot of times I like just to hit several, get a little space so I can see what's, move away from the clutter. Copy. Copy, not cut. one thing about setting up an email address, email server, as we're doing here, you want it to be done right. You want it to be to really show that, look, you're doing things right, you're doing the protocol right, so that you don't get rejected by other email servers. If you do it sloppy, there's going to be email servers out there to reject you. And they should. This actually has a lot of other messages too, but there's a problem. If it's going well, you're really not going to see much useful as far as what we're doing here, but if there's a problem, that'll let you pick up on it. Okay, so now we need to pick this one. Copy. Now we need this here. And here. We're going to start, as here it says, start with the V equals, and we want to end where it has the parentheses. We do not want to include any quotation marks, any spaces, carriage returns, all that. So let's get that. And put that below. Put it right here. Go ahead and copy this here. Here's our example. Copy. Paste. Just put a little space there. Makes it easier to compare when it's just right underneath you. The other one, this kind of a. So let's go with it. We got V equals. We want to copy that all the way to here. No spaces, no quotation marks, no parentheses. Copy. And what we get, we'll take these other quotation marks out. Spacing there is not important. It just makes it easier to see what a comparison. You can see how it looks up above. And we'll take the spaces and quotation marks out. And carriage returns out. You can see we're making it look more like the above example. Another quotation mark, carriage return in space. Another quotation mark. You'll notice this is all lowercase. I just made that up. That's not actual one there. But just kind of similar idea. Just so you can kind of get an idea what it should look like. And that's it. So, what we got to do, we got to make a mail domain key text record in the DNS. So, copy that. Let's see, where is it? Yeah, here we go. And we want it to be text. Paste. And you'll see it shows domain key and it inserts your domain name. It's actually going to need testing in there because that's what I'm using. That's my let's see if we go back. You can see that's what it should look like. As your example here. And we need to get the data. Shift end. Copy. And there we go. Let's go there. All right, create. There we go. There's our one we just created. And now we need to test this thing, make sure it's good. Right. Is that being at this web address right there? Copy. And then we want to enter the selector and then domain name. So we'll go back to here. Our selector is mail or mail. Copy. Paste. Domain name. Copy. Paste. Check. And there we go. So this is a valid record. So it is good. No errors there. All right. Then we have to enable the fail to ban items that we had disabled before. Copy, paste. And the last one will give us an error, but that's fine because it just lets us know it's working. It'll say already running. And you can run this. Copy. Fail to ban can be rather tricky, so don't let it waste too much of your time, but everything looks good. And let's make sure everything works after a reboot. And then this rebooting helps. I'm just setting, installing all this stuff. Okay, connection refused. Probably hadn't fully rebooted. There we go. And of course our tmux that we had running is gone since we rebooted. So if you type tmux attach, it didn't attach to. And then next time you can type tmux attach and be right in there. Alright, let's see. And that is it. We have done it. That's how you do it. Set up your server, mail server, and all that stuff. The freedom, it takes a little while. As you can see, it's a nice long video here, and I could have gone into more detail on a lot of that stuff, but I wanted a full video going from beginning to end, setting everything up and exactly what you need to do so you can actually just follow it and do it. If there's anything on there that looks confusing, you can always look it up and research and make decisions and all that kind of stuff. You can post questions on the Facebook page. Do some research. I mean, you don't just expect everything to be answered for you, but that gives you the freedom to be able to set up your own server and do so, without spending more money than you're spending on your shared server setup, and you have so much more freedom. It takes a little more knowledge. It takes patience, but if you're finding that you're in a situation where your server, your setup is just getting in the way, the only time you have to contact technical support is when they've messed something up for you, and you get your own server, set it up, and you don't have someone messing up your shared server like you do with shared server. It's just have your own virtual server, you have full control, be able to do just about anything you want. It's just, the freedom is just great. It's an awesome way to go. All right, thanks for watching.